and Advent. It means the arrival. It means that the one we were waiting for has come. And the prophets for hundreds of years had looked forward to the arrival of Christ, and they had prophesied and they had given utterance from God, a declaration that the one who was promised, the Messiah, would come. And so we celebrate that Jesus has arrived, and Advent is a season of waiting. Now, maybe you grew up in a church, maybe like my wife, and you grew up in a church where Advent was familiar, so it's something that you've celebrated before. Or maybe you're like me, and you don't have a faith tradition that's given you any context for what Advent means, but that's okay, because essentially Advent means it's the countdown to Christmas. And so together we are counting down toward Christmas. It's the season of waiting for the arrival. Now, I think a more modern understanding of Advent can be explained with three letters, OMW. And if you know what OMW means, go ahead and tell the person next to you that you know what it means. Tell them what it means. OMW, if you don't know, if the person next to you didn't know, OMW means on my way. Now, OMW is a text that you send. I mean, it's a helpful text. Like when you were traveling, and basically, I've been known to send this text. If I'm heading home, or I'm going to meet somebody, or head to the gym, I just text OMW, right? And then they just know on my way. But it gets complicated, because now on the iPhone, there's a default setting that when you text those three words, OMW, it automatically puts in on my way with an exclamation point. Which is like this passive aggressive like move that now I'm yelling at you for being concerned about where I'm at. And so now instead of my lack of punctuality, now it's about your impatience. I mean, so this gets a little complicated with on my way, exclamation point. Thank you, iPhone, for letting people know. And so when you send in on my way, and like, here's the thing, I don't mind sending an OMW, but I don't like to receive an OMW because I have no idea what that means. Like, I don't know. For some people, when they type OMW, it means they just got out of bed. For other people, they text OMW, and it means they're thinking about leaving the house. For others, it means they're, see, those words don't help me. The three letters don't help me because I don't know what that means. I don't know where you are. I don't know how fast you're moving. I don't know when you'll be here. And the reason that we don't like OMW is because we don't like to wait. Especially when we don't know how long we'll wait. In the Christmas season, Advent is a season of waiting. It's a season of waiting. And Christmas, I don't know if you realize this, but Christmas has a way of throwing in our face the other things we're waiting for too. Maybe waiting for a job, or waiting for a relationship, or waiting for a child, or waiting for a child to come home, or waiting to get out of debt. Maybe it's waiting for a relationship to be reconciled, or waiting for a diagnosis, or waiting for a miracle, or waiting for a breakthrough, or waiting for a loved one to find Jesus. Christmas has a way of reminding us the things that we're waiting for in life. And waiting is the most difficult work of faith. Lewis Smedes, who's a pastor, theologian, look with me at what he writes. He says, "Waiting is our destiny. As creatures who cannot by themselves bring about what they hope for, we wait in the darkness for a flame we cannot light. We wait in fear for a happy ending that we cannot write. We wait for a not yet that feels like a not ever." Wow. And Christmas, in a season of waiting, it reminds us of the things that we're waiting for, and we don't like to wait. We hate to wait. Especially when we don't know how long it is that we're going to be waiting for. And Advent is a celebration of the arrival of the one that human history is waiting for. And that Jesus arrives, and it's the miracle upon miracles that God came near. That divinity put on human flesh and dwelt among us. That he lived among us. And that Mary and Joseph and some shepherds, as Mary held in her arms Jesus took his first breath, he would become the one who would take away the sin of the world. And so Advent is the miracle that Christ has arrived, but there was a lot of waiting that went before that. In the Bibles, I don't know if you realize it, but there's one page that separates the Old Testament from the New Testament. And this one page that separates the Old Covenant from the New Covenant is, or the Old Contract from the New Contract, This one page represents 400 years. 400 years of waiting. See, the last text that God sent was this word that there would be a messenger. It says, I will send you a messenger, and he will turn the hearts of parents to their children and the hearts of children to their parents. So God, he texts the nation of Israel. He says, I'm going to send a messenger like that. In other words, that text is just on my way. And then it's silence. It's like the three blue little dots, you know, just back and forth. They're like, okay, God, you got anything else? He's like, I'm on my way. And they're waiting. 50 years, 100 years. And don't you hate when those dots go away? When the dots go away, and then it's just nothing. 400 years, they wait. 400 years, the nation of Israel waits. And there's another text that you can send back after somebody sends an OMW, and it's this. It's a WYA. You know what WYA means? Where you at? And I wonder, like, how many times Israel's texting God in that 400 years, like, where are you at, God? Like, you said you were on your way. You said you would send a messenger, but where are you at? God, have you forgotten about us? God, do you even care about us? God, here we are in silence, and you're not speaking. God, where are you at? And I wonder, how many times have you sent that prayer? God, where are you at? It doesn't look anything like what you promised. God, the thing that I thought you were going to do, you haven't done. Where are you at, God? And in our distress and in our waiting, we send up these prayers to God. God, where are you at? Have you forgotten about me? And God says, I'm on my way. And if you feel like you're in that place, I want you to know today you're in really good company. Because throughout the centuries, throughout the history of our faith, have been those who wait. I mean, in fact, when you flip the page and you go over to Matthew chapter 1, it's the genealogy that Matthew gives us leading up to Christ. It's kind of the who's who of waiting. I mean, you look at the text and it just kind of leads it out. This is genealogy. Matthew's point to Jesus is to come, and he tells us the kind of the family tree, and he pulls out Abraham, and Abraham is kind of the patron saint of waiting. Abraham was 75 years old when God told him, you're going to have a son. Imagine being 75 and told you're going to have a son. Come on, Sarah. I mean, there's and so he's thinking this is going to happen fast. He waited 24 years. 24 years. That's a lot of chasing Sarah. 24 years until that promise was fulfilled. And then Abraham has a son named Isaac, and Isaac waits 40 years for a wife. He waits another 20 years for a son. And you got Jacob. And Esau, his two sons, and Jacob and Esau have this broken relationship, and they wait 20 years for their estranged relationship to be made whole. 20 years of waiting. You just kind of keep going down through the list. A lot of waiting going on. You come to Ruth, and Ruth, she was barren. She was a widow, and she waited. God eventually brought her Boaz, who would become her husband. Her kinsman redeemer, he would become her husband, and who gave her a child. And then you go down and you find that she was the great grandmother of David, King David. And God answered her prayer. And David, when he was 13, Samuel came to him and said, you are anointed to be the king of Israel, when he was 13. But he had to wait 17 years for that word to be made reality in his life. 17 years of waiting. He had the anointing, but not the crown. And Saul, King Saul, had the crown, but not the anointing. And Saul was threatened by David, and so he sought to kill him. And so David hid in the wilderness, in the caves, and he waited on the Lord for 17 years. And in those 17 years, God was preparing in him the heart of a king. And so for 17 years, he waited. And you keep going down through, and then you find like there's this exile. It says that there's an exile in Babylon. That's 70 years that the nation of Israel was in exile, and they waited. But you just go through this list, and you could go through a lot more of these names, and you could find that there's waiting involved in the lives of the people of God. And God has his people wait. Now, we get to the very end of that, and then there's this verse, and it says, and Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, and Mary was the mother of Jesus, who is called the Messiah. So Jesus shows up and the waiting is over. the fulfillment of all the promises of God. He is the one that God promised to Abraham. He said, I will send one who will be a blessing, who will bless the nations. He is the fulfillment of what God told David when he said, David, I'm going to give from your descendants, I'm going to give a king whose rule will reign forever. Jesus is the fulfillment of those promises. But when Jesus shows up, a lot of people didn't see that he was the Messiah because he wasn't what they were looking for. They were looking for a king and they were looking for a deliverer. They were looking for a rescuer and instead they got a baby. So a lot of people didn't realize this is the Messiah. I mean, you only have a handful of people. You got Mary, you got Joseph, you got some shepherds, you got some wise men, a little nativity scene going on at your house. I mean, those are the people who saw this is the Messiah. You add to that Simeon and Anna, two people who went to the temple every single day and they cried out and they prayed and they intercede for the nation of Israel and they're praying, God, would you send a deliverer? And then there's this moment where they go to present Jesus at the temple and they go and they present him and Simeon holds Jesus and he says, this is the one that I've waited for my entire life. This old man, Simeon, says, this is the one I've waited for. He says, my wait is over. God, you can take me home. He said, this is the one I've waited for. And this is this beautiful moment where the promise has been fulfilled. But the irony is that Jesus is an infant, which means more waiting until he begins his ministry. And so God has his people wait. But then Christmas, we see God saying, I'm on my way. And where you at? And Christmas is a celebration that I am here. Yeah, I am is here. I don't know if God uses emojis, but if he did, I would just. But the I am is here. That God made good on his promise. And so our hope is in the reality and the truth that Jesus has come, that the I am has shown up. But we hate to wait. I read something recently about a cardiologist named Dr. Friedman from out in San Francisco. And in his waiting room, he went to have the chairs reupholstered. And we went to get the chairs reupholstered, and the upholsterer looked at the chairs. He's like, I got to show you something. He said, this is different. He said, when you look at these chairs, he said, these chairs are worn out at the front of the chair. They're worn out at the front of the chair, and chairs don't wear out that way. Something is different about your waiting room and how people are using the chairs. And here's what they realized is that in the waiting room of the cardiologist, that people were waiting at the front of the chairs. He said, normally chairs wear out in the back. But in the waiting room of the cardiologist, people were waiting in the front. So you got people like nervously fidgeting as they wait for the doctor. In which Dr. Friedman asked a question. He said, are people nervously fidgeting and waiting because they're waiting in the waiting room of a cardiologist? Or are they in the office of a cardiologist because they're stressed out about waiting for everything else in life? And Advent is a season of waiting. And all of us are waiting for something. So the question is, how do we wait in a way that's not killing us? How do we wait in a way that's not killing us? And there's some things that we need to know. And we got to remember in the waiting. The first is that you're an important part of God's plan. If you're taking notes, I want you to take that in and write that down, that you are an important part of God's plan. Now, in hindsight, if you talk to every person in that genealogy, in hindsight, they'd be able to go back and say, okay, I see it now. I see how I was an important part of God's plan. I see how I was a part of shaping the redemption of human history. I see how I made a difference. I see that my life mattered. But at the time, it would have been hard for them to see. In fact, there were many of those people who would be shocked that they made the list. Because when you go back, you find that there were idolaters and adulterers. There were murderers. There were Gentiles. There's a prostitute. And there were all kinds of people who lived all kinds of lives. There were people who had made a mess of their lives. And they're included in. I mean, this is a crooked family tree. You would think that when Matthew's making this genealogy, there are some people that he would have cropped out of the family picture. But he kept calling people into the family picture. He's like, no, let's frame this up. And it shouldn't surprise us that Matthew included those people in the genealogy, because Matthew was one of those people. Remember, before Matthew was a disciple, he was a tax collector, which was one of the most despised groups of people in the nation of Israel. And Matthew's letting us know that no matter where you've been or what you've done, you can get in on God's plan. That God includes you in his plan. And not just that you get in, but you have an important part to play. Because the grace and the redemption of Christ, the grace and truth that he brings, you're an important part of God's plan. So you need to know that. But you also need to know, not just are you an important part of God's plan, but you need to know that that God's plan is bigger than you. See, sometimes we can make it so much about our little thing that we're working on. We can make it about the thing that we're waiting on, the thing that's not right, the thing that we're hopeful for. We can make it about our thing and we miss the bigger picture that's going on. We forget that it's bigger than us. President Theodore Roosevelt, he had this nightly ritual where he would go out with his friend William Beebe, who was a naturalist. He would go out with him, and they would go up, and they would look up in the sky, under the night sky, and they'd look at the stars. And then they kind of had this thing that they would recite together. I want to show it to you. He says, this is a spiral galaxy of Andromeda. It is as large as our Milky Way. It's one of the 100 million galaxies. It is 750,000 light years away. It consists of 100 billion suns, each larger than our own. And then he said, now I think we feel small enough. Let's go to bed. Have you ever noticed that there's something about looking up at the stars that just kind of right-sizes us? It just kind of recalibrates the soul. And it helps us see how big God is and how small we are. But instead of going to our bed underneath the glow of the stars, we go to bed underneath the glow of our phones, which has a way of making us either think that life is all about us, or we go to bed comparing ourselves with other people, with what they're filtering and curating and putting out into the world, and we go to bed depressed. And that's why, like, in this series, we're reminding ourselves about the plan and the promises of God. I mean, there's a reason that God told Abraham, I want you to go out underneath the stars, and I want you to look up at the stars, and he made a promise. I'm going to give you descendants as numerous as the stars. There's a reason that God had him look up at the stars, because Abraham was never more than 12 hours away from the promises and plans of God, from being reminded. And we need to build into our lives rhythms where we are aware of God's plan and his promise. That's why we're excited together to go through the Advent devotionals, this preparing our hearts for remembering Christ and celebrating Christ's arrival. And so we're partnering with She Reads Truth and He Reads Truth, and want to invite you to be a part of that. You can subscribe by going to the site, subscribe for free emails that you get every single day. So kind of the first thing that you see could be to prepare your heart and to remember the promises of God. Or if you're old school analog and you want a book that you can hold, you can pick that up in the lobby on your way out, and you can, at cost, they've partnered with us, and you can purchase that. But through this season, we're slowing down and we're reminding ourselves that God is good, and that he makes good on his promises, and that we can trust him. We can trust him. And in those waiting seasons, we learn to see God like we've never seen him before. And we learn to trust God like we've never trusted him before. See, it's in the waiting season. Here's what I'll say. If God gave you everything that you desire, it would crush you. But it's in the waiting seasons that he builds the inner scaffolding to be able to hold up the thing that he's prepared for us. In the waiting season, God is preparing you for the thing he has prepared for you. But it's through reminding ourselves of the plan and promises of God that gives us strength in the midst of the waiting. And so I hope you'll join us for this journey up to Christmas as we move through these devotionals together. And find strength in those and reminding ourselves of the promise and the plan of God. And waiting on God, if you're taking notes, waiting on God is trusting that he has a plan. It's trusting that he has a plan. My daughter Raleigh, who's 15, she has a favorite verse. It's kind of a life verse for her. And it's Jeremiah 29:11. Let me share it with you. It says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. That's a great verse. And what this verse is, it's a promise. It's a promise that God said, I have plans for you. Here's what that verse means. It means that God has specific plans for your life. And he has specific plans for my life. And his plans for you are not the same as his plans for me. And his plans for me are not the same as his plans for you. He has specific plans for your life. And this verse was important for Raleigh when we moved last year and we moved up to Nashville and she's in a new city and new school and new church and everything's new. And I drew strength from her verse too, going, okay, God, I know you've got us here and I'm trusting God that you have plans. And maybe you're in a new city and you just need to be reminded afresh today that God has plans for you and he hasn't forgotten about you. Because the reason when he gave this verse to the prophet Jeremiah was in those 70 years of exile. When the nation of Israel is in Babylon, God gave this verse to you. He says, I know that you're away from your homeland, but I haven't forgotten about you. I still have plans for you. And in the waiting, I have plans for you. And I even have plans while you're waiting. You can trust. I haven't forgotten. You need to know today that God hasn't forgotten about you. That he's still at work in your life and through your life. And even though you might look around and you say, this isn't what I thought it would be, God has you where he wants you and he has plans for you. And even if you've made a mess of things, there's this glorious truth called redemption. And that God can take your mess, even in the waiting, and work things out for his good and for his glory. But it's trusting God. You have a plan. I'm trusting you. See, maybe today you come in here and you're sitting just like this. And today God's saying, I want you to just sit back. There's a big difference between this and this. Maybe everything inside of you is on the edge of your seat. And God said, I just want you to sit back and just trust. At my house in the mornings, I sit on this green corduroy couch and we got a fireplace. I don't like build a fire with wood. I just flip a switch. And so I turn on the fireplace and I sit down. And as I'm sitting, looking at the fire, I get out the scriptures and I'm reading. And I used to kind of sit like this, but now I kind of do this on that green. And this green couch has been handed down for generations and generations. It's like my wife's grandmother's couch, and we still have it. And I just kind of sit back, and I just find a way of sliding back in that couch. Sometimes I pull that hoodie up like that, and I'll just sit. And I'll just sit on the couch, and I look up, and there's this tray that somebody gave us when we moved. It's this tray it's kind of this decorative tray, and it has a verse on it, and it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not on your own understanding. And in all of your ways, acknowledge him, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. And sometimes I'll just sit back. And when I prop my head up, I can see that just perfect. And it reminds me that God has a plan. And that I can trust in him. Now, I used to think it was maybe a little bit like a lack of reverence to lean back. But I'm starting to believe that it is It's a sacred posture for me because I can live too much of my life like this. And God's saying, will you just lean back and trust me? Will you just trust me? And what's interesting is God has never unveiled the blueprint for my life. I don't know 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 years from now. And I think the reason that God has never given me the blueprint for my life is because if he gave me the blueprint, I'd just run off and start trying to build it. I mean, I wouldn't trust in God. I'd trust in the plan. And I think what God wants me to know is that more than what I could do for him and more than what I could build for him, he wants to build a relationship with me. And maybe you're looking for the blueprint. And God never promised a blueprint. He promised that you can trust in him and he'll make clear the next step. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways, submit to him, and he's going to make your path straight. But it means that you're going to have to trust him with your plans. In fact, if you're taking notes, you can write that down. Waiting on God means we surrender our plans to him. We trust him with our plans. Look with me. We want to see what this looks like. Look with me at verse 18. It says, now this is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Now hold up, can you imagine that conversation she's having with Joseph? Joseph, I'm pregnant, but you don't have anything to worry about. I haven't been with anyone. It's God's job. An angel came to me, and can you imagine being Mary and having that conversation? Can you imagine being Joseph? Well, Joseph, he came up with a plan. Look with me. It says, because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. He came up with a plan. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. And she will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which is God, means God with us. And when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Advent happens because Joseph was willing to surrender his plans to God. See, Joseph never planned for Mary to get pregnant. Joseph never planned for the rumors to fly around Nazareth. Joseph never planned to adopt his first child. He never planned to be a refugee in Egypt. He never planned to raise the Messiah in his home. I mean, just talk about pressure. The Son of God is in your home. It's your job to raise the Son of God. I mean, Jesus is watching, literally. Like, he is watching at all times. Like, don't mess this up, Joseph. This is a big deal. Just think about that pressure. But God had plans that were greater than anything that Joseph could imagine. But to live those plans, Joseph had to surrender his own. And we can surrender our plans, and we can wait. If you're taking notes, you can write this down. Because even while we are waiting, God is working. Even while we're waiting, God is working. And instead of teaching this point, I want to share a story with you. It's a powerful story. A story that illustrates this truth in a way you won't forget. Listen in to Jim's story.
God has been pursuing me my whole life, and that's because of the prayers of my father and my mother that are 92 and 91 years old. I kind of knew they were praying, but I really didn't know how they were praying. And there were some things going on in my life that my father never threw in my face. He just always loved me, never condemned me. And then I started coming to CrossPoint about a year ago, and I saw him baptize about 75 people on a Sunday. I said, wow, that is just amazing. I said, I want to be a part of that. So I came on a Sunday morning. It was July 8th this summer. They had a big pool outside, and I knew as soon as I walked past it, I knew that was the day. That was like a landmark. It is like putting a pointer in the ground. And I grabbed this verse, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And that's because of his love. So after I was baptized this summer, I got with my folks, and they told me their prayers had been answered. They had been praying for me for 40 years. She said, you know, the first thing your dad does when he gets up in the morning, he gets on his knees. I didn't know that. And then after breakfast, they pull out their Bibles. They have a devotional. I just wept at the breakfast table. I mean, their love just overwhelmed me. But it wasn't their love. I'd been running from God all that time. And it was his love. But my father and then my mother, they were faithful. They never gave up. Just like my father had that relationship with God, and now I have that relationship with my father, and I have a relationship with my heavenly father. It has all come full circle. It's beautiful.
Come on. And they were praying. And they were waiting. And all that time, God was working. And when Messiah comes, he'll turn the hearts of children to their fathers and the hearts of fathers to their children. Something that only he can do. And we're reminded from that story, the power of prayer. For 40 years, they prayed every single day for their son, Jim. Some of you need that reminder today to continue in prayer, to continue to hold on in hope and in faith and trust in God. But I want to lead you in a moment of prayer. We've heard about the power of prayer. I want to pray for you. And after we pray, we're going to have an opportunity to worship together where we would sing our prayer to God. But in order for us to pray together, I want to invite you into a moment. I want to invite you in your seat. I want to invite you to sit toward the front of your chair. Some of you are already there, so you've beaten to it, but I want you to sit at the front of your chair. And let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your love for us. And it's out of your love for us that you watch over us, that you care for us, that you tend to our hearts. And God, you know the things that we are waiting on. You know the things that we are waiting for. You know the places in our hearts and our lives where not yet feels like not ever. God, you know our anxiety, and you know our worries, and you know our doubts, and you know our fear, and you know our frustration, and you know our sense of urgency. But God, your word reminds us that you have a plan and that you can be trusted. And so God, today, our hearts are saying we trust in you. So I want to invite you to kind of lean back in your chair. By leaning back, just an act of faith and saying, God, we trust you. So I pray that right now, I pray that through the power of your Spirit, that you would give us the peace that comes only from the Prince of Peace. That you would give us the faith, that you would increase our faith to be able to trust. God, that you would give us eyes to see where you are working. That you would give us words of encouragement from other people and from your scriptures that remind us of your plans and your promises. God, that our hope would be placed in you, that even more than the things that we are hoping for, that God, our hope, our ultimate hope is in you. And that the reality of Christ's arrival in the earth and that Christ has shown up in our hearts would give us the peace, the faith, and the trust to know that God, even while we're waiting, you are working. So would you teach us how to pray in the waiting? And would you give us the hope to hold on? And that God, when you answer, when you meet us in that, that we would give you all the glory and the praise. We find you in Jesus' name.